that those masses themselves don't change much. I mean, the basic volume and shape of the rib cage, the basic volume and shape of the pelvis, not to change much, but their relation changes. So I brought in a mannequin. It's actually an antique. Now, an antique, one standard measure for an antique has got to be 100 years old. Well, this is more than that. This was a mannequin used by a sculptor who studied with Rodin. It was given to my father by a fellow who taught at Yale for years, taught in the sculpture department. And it's not in bad shape, actually. It's put together quite carefully. And it has set screws, brass fittings, and set screws so you can tighten or loosen its joints. And it moves much as the figure does. And the shapes are not bad. The fellow who owned this studied with a sculptor named Mercier, who was a student of Rodin. And Mercier himself, an immense career. He's a lawyer. Watch what happens with the torso. This torso is designed to move, to approximate the movement in a figure. So for those of you who have been drawing up to this point, figures that look sort of like this, in the reference position, as if it were cast in plaster, that's not the deal. Otherwise, they wouldn't go to all this trouble. Watch what happens. It's pretty clever, because it gives you shapes, it gives you movement, volumes, relationships. It has little bits of plaster here and there, because I suspect it might have been used for drapery studies. But just to explore aspects of movement as you develop an idea, I think principally. Most of these people of this era had life-size mannequins, not little ones like this, in order to study drapery. If you had a draped figure, you needed a life-size mannequin so that you could arrange things and have them not move. The problem with drapery is you compose a model and they take a rest and then they go back in. It's all different. You can't study. You're going to be inventing things. So, my question to follow on last week is why would somebody go to all this trouble to organize this and to construct it with this in mind, that the torso should be so arranged that it can move this dramatically? It's, you know, it's a bit of a stretch, but pretty good, and flexes. Flex all these joints. Flexing means bending. Actually, you could move this either way and flex it. Called dorsiflexion. This is called plantar flexion. Flex the head, flex the torso, flex the arm, fancy word for bend. Flex the hand, good. Everything flexed here, so in a closed position. You could think your way into a solution for a piece of sculpture. Then quick, abandon this and go to something else. The point is, it can move. You don't want to think of the torso as static. Otherwise, all you have to do is build one big block here and stick arms and legs to it. Not the way it's designed. You're welcome to look at this later, but move it carefully. I don't want to take it home in pieces. So, we set up this as a proposal. Ways of getting the figure to move, ways of thinking about getting the figure to move, that it has to do with relating this mass to this mass. What I did was to take it to a certain level in this drawing, but not to the next really important step. The next really important step has to do with appraising your work, finding out if you've got it or not. It has to be part of it. Otherwise, you just sketch, flip the page, sketch, flip the page, do a drawing, figure that it looks all right, but never have any strategy that's going to allow you to fix it if it's broken. To put it in the vernacular, the way you appraise a drawing, you have a model as your reference, you have a drawing going over here, is to make comparisons. If you don't make the comparisons, you never get the relationships in space. If I hold this thing up, I mean, it makes a difference whether it's doing this, the relation of the head to something below, or this, the relation of the head to something below, or this, the relation of something on one side in relation to something on the other. Those are the comparisons I'm talking about. Or if it's like this, what is the relation of the head in relation to the knee? What is the situation? So in a drawing, you're trying to come up with elements of movement, but also put a control on it so that you know how you're doing. So at some point, let's say we've got this going, and perhaps this is enough, but it has nothing on here for arms. And, I did another drawing over there. If this one fails, it's miserable. But you see, this represents just a beginning stage of things where I'm trying to sort out the relation of position. Instead of go to all of these shapes too soon, don't declare too soon when you're developing a drawing. Make a suggestion of where you think it is. Reason? You've probably never seen, witnessed, and figured exactly this position ever before when we posed the model. Something similar, but never exactly the same. So you have to stay open to monitoring how you're doing and responding to that situation. You have to stay open to that. Don't declare too soon. People think that by going for all these shapes with a dark black line means that you've solved it. All that means is you've jumped ahead and you've elected to represent all of these different overlapping muscle groups and flatten them all out into one line, in one shape, and take the risk that you're hitting it right at the first go. You're willing to take that risk. Isn't it smarter to forecast where you're going with the leg? Come up with some sort of recommendation, suggestion, decision on what its length is, what its angle is, and then make the lightest of suggestions of where the contour exists on that leg. Because I would expect that very few would hit it exactly so the first time. So best strategy, go lightly. So I have an arm control. So I have this position, possible position for the arm. It's abducted, it's out here somewhere. The priorities are, where does it start, where does it go, and furthermore, what is its relation to the rest of the figure? Otherwise, it's somebody else's arm. It doesn't belong to this figure. So you need to study the relation of this. This plan, as a plan for the drawing of an arm, before you get into all of its shapes. I don't care whether you use this as your strategy or some other strategy. You go to the shapes, stay light. Don't overcommit to it too soon. So, among my concerns would be, how high is the shoulder in relation to the head? That puts control on the whole thing. If I drop my arm, it impacts on the position of the whole thing. If I raise the shoulder, it changes everything in relation to the rest of the figure. And the shapes will be wonderful. exactly that way with those lines. What I'm suggesting is some equivalent of this. The principle behind this is a good one, because it's a plan for where you're going with everything. The next thing that I would suggest is to step back and see how that looks in relation to the rest of the figure, because from up here I can't see that. I can only see how it looks from back here. It looks big. It looks long. This looks too low for the position of the shoulder. I'm so glad I'm videotaping all my errors here, but anyhow, maybe that's one way of teaching. What do you do? Well, you see there's these two little boxes down in your drawing. You don't realize they're there. They're on every piece of drawing paper, at least on all those papers where you care about your drawing. You may not have seen them before, but they're there. One has a Y in it, and one has a no. Yes, that's where that is, or no, it's not there. One or the other, no hedging. You can find out where this wants to be. This is I, you have a model posing, you can make this comparison. There's a bone point here called medial condyle. You can stop and see at a glance, in a second and a half, where that is in relation to the rest of the figure. And this is coming out long. I can't have this low while I have this high, or I'm stretching my bones. So good thing I didn't get over declarative, too dark on the position of that wrist and hand, because it's in the wrong place. Another glance across and see what the relation is to some other identifiable part of the figure. Don't take something over in here, because you can't be sure that you're going to find that same spot every time. That's why you want to use a bone point or some sort of landmark. Something you can find every single time with no doubt. Otherwise, your reference is floating and it's no good. I want to flex this. This is my plan for flexing it. I've raised it some. Using your osseous muscle. Wrist. Extended digits. Something like that. I'm not sure that's correct, but making a change is a good thing. So now I have this for a. I believe it's a good thing to learn how to scan through the figure. You do it your way, and then guided by the same principles that are guiding this. I don't care how you get there, but you do it your way. If it involves shapes, that's fine. Lines, directions of things, angles of things, that's good. But come up with some version of simplifying the figure. You have to do that. You're not going to get the full figure by the addition of details to something that's poorly conceived in the first place. It's not going to happen. Just to have the right number of fingers doesn't mean you have a good drawing of the hand. That's the point. All right, so there should be strategies that I'm suggesting here. And the sooner we can get our drawing straightened out, the sooner we can apply some of this stuff to it and give it more authority. So this should go around. Well, I'll put it under flawed drawing here. Just because I have a head, two shoulders, an arm, a couple of legs, as well as a torso. Paint on it that I covered with a masking tape. Looks like a band-aid. I'm at a stage in this drawing, in other words, where I've been pretty declarative about what I've got. Don't fool yourself. Just because you have a shoulder on here and a head and a neck and torso and it seems to move, and at first glance it seems like it's all right and has some bone points, has some references, setting up your drawing, you know, the angle of his leg. Just like that. You'd have to restructure this whole thing. More horizontal. Or it isn't. So you have to concern yourself with angles. Or you get things in the wrong place. So there ought to be some, it struck me, I wasn't taught this way. Direct principle was the same, but I wasn't taught this way. There ought to be some way of forecasting where are you going with this, this, and this. And it strikes me that I can't get to any lesser number of lines than three. Because one line gives me the axis for this upper leg, this line gives me the axis of the lower leg, and this for foot. If you come up with a lesser number, I want to hear about it.
Deane?
Yes.
You said using bone points or landmarks.
Yeah, the nail is not a bone point.
Could an ear be considered a landmark?
Yes, if you think of it this way. Where part of the ear is a rather straight, offers a straight construction line and the rest is curved. But, yes, it's possible. All your landmarks refer to those soft and fleshy places that you could identify like navel, compared to bone points like trochanter, which is part of the femur. Bone points are useful because they're pretty much fixed and you can compare one side to the other, particularly bilaterally. Anyhow, this drawing, done from memory a few minutes ago, I would want to review. And the reason I'm doing this now in this class, in this context of anatomy, is this. We can't get into this material until the drawings are at a certain level of performance. It doesn't make sense. Why add the brachialis muscle on here if the arm isn't any good? Or at least you don't know any strategies about how to check the relation of the arm to something else in the face. Or how great it should be compared to a height. How far out it should be compared to a height. How far out it should be compared to this distance down. Keyword, comparisons. And you can't make them, as I am standing here close to this board, I can't make those comparisons from here. So I can only see this much of this drawing at one time, wherever I'm looking. If I back up, I can see a little bit more, a little bit more, a little bit more. And generally it works out that if you take this 2.5 times your back here, then you can see it pretty much at a glance without having to move your eyes around too much. Called a visual angle. With your eye and a side view. Look something like this. Nose over here, you're looking out, and you can see this, you know, a segment of the circle, just so much. So that's the reason you want to step back as you're drawing. You're not drawing from the scale, most of you. You're at 24, 18, 24. So you need to be back 5 feet every now and then to see what's going on. Visual comparisons. Let me make a few with this. Let me show you how to make a suspect. I think the upper body is too heavy. I think this is too slight. Everything in the figure gets heavier in construction as you go down. Pelvis, look at the comparison of femur to humerus, the lower leg to forearm, and foot to hand. Everything's heavier. Well, this looks heavy. This looks top heavy. This doesn't look big enough. This looks possible. This needs to be more massive. That's one thing. Usually I pick out three things because I can't remember more than three. Pick out three. Something wrong in the stiffness of all of this. I don't trust that. I don't believe that. I think there's four curves to the spine. I've got three. flat, too straight. It's too straight. And you may get that visually, you may get that just cognitively, you may get it just empathetically. You may say, something wrong with this. So off it goes. So better for you, if your strategy is to start lightly, you don't start too heavily, because you may have a change to make. You need to allow yourself, give yourself that capability of introducing a change. Without tearing through the paper, this has to come back. Only four occurs. I think by now, having started all this in 1961, that I would set up a drawing remembering there's four occurs to this pun. I didn't. I thought this was fine. It wasn't. But I caught it. Starting place. But it's pretty much totally without movement. You can't have this in a reference position. On forward. You've seen it in some anatomy books. You've seen it in some drawings, probably. I think you loosen that one. I mean, it's handy because it tells you, you don't have to explain everything about the figure. All you have to say to somebody who's aware of this, that, all right, if you start in the reference position, then we're going to move it in a certain sort of a way. So this is what everybody knows about the reference position. This is it. I'll tell you, though, I've rarely seen this in life. I've seen everything but in life. So knowing that that's what this is, that's enough. But all I see when I look around and draw marketplaces and all these other things, right, so how do you respond to this when you're drawing? You go through, you work your drawing. Don't measure first. It's not about sets of coordinates. People do that. But you're robbing yourself of any response whatsoever if you're thinking of this in terms of sets of coordinates. This is going to be two little units higher than this. I'm saying just trust your eye. When you draw this line, it's going to be inclined at a certain position. Don't worry about how many units. So you make your drawing, as I made this one. But then you stop. And you see, subjected to some appraisal. It just makes sense. It's like writing the theme and then reading it over, see how it's done. All right, so I'm going to make those. I made some visual ones, but I was kind of off at three. I changed this. I think that's the main one. I'm not sure that this doesn't look just a little big. If this is coming back at me, which is suggested by this cross contour, then maybe it shouldn't be quite so long. If I had a model in front of me, I could find out. Take me about 3 seconds. If this is right, then I can use this as a reference for locating this field. Here's the question. Is it so that from the margin of the trapezius, and it seems to coincide with the root of the spine of the scapula, which is this thing, and the post muscles of the back, the retrospinae muscles, is it so that all this, part of the sacrum, and the heel are all on a line or not? It's yes or no. That rigorous. We've got a model holding a position up here, presumably. So if this is a question in my mind, then it is. Then part of this question can be sorted out by asking this question. Is it so that the heel is in line with these points on the model or not? If it isn't, I've got to find a new place for this. Another kind of comparison. How long? Try to stay with me on this. If you do, I'll let you out a little early.
Good.
I know the glazed look and the after lunch look. A warm fall day look. How long is this? Well, I don't care in terms of inches, yards, cubits, hectares, whatever it is. The full question is, how long should this leg be in relation to some other part of the figure? Why am I asking that question? Because I want to relate this figure and hitch the right leg to the right person. Not just think of this by itself. It's in the context of this particular figure. So, I'm determining what points I'm using to gain a unit of measure laterally. It's my question. This looks too long. equal, which, close, to this one. So far, so good. That doesn't mean anything until you make the same comparisons on the model, where you go like this on the model and you capture this distance on the leg and see if indeed that's the same from here to here. If it is, we're okay. If it isn't, we're in trouble. You gotta make a change. Who wants me to review that? Don't be shy. Because if you can do this in your work, if you can make enough comparisons, anything that looks weird, it probably is. You need to go back in and know how to fix it. This is how you fix it, by making comparisons. You will never have an amateur performance in life drawing ever again if you use this strategy. You can have plenty of mediocre days, but you won't have an outrageously poor, out-of-control day ever again if you use this strategy at this point in time. I didn't measure. First thing when I started this drawing, I didn't mark off this page. Line and center, foot, head. I didn't do that. I drew the figure. Just responding, drawing class, and a measuring class. But then, in support of the merit of this and these decisions, I can stop and see if these are any good. I'm drawing with charcoal. I can change this drawing easily if I'm using this medium. I'm using watercolor or Connie Crane dipped in oil. I can't make the change so readily. So that's why this is such a long tradition of using this, because you can get rid of what's poor. The assumption is when you're learning stuff, you're going to have lots of changes to make because you won't hit it right the first time. Awfully silent in here. Ask me if you're concerned about what I just did. See, there's four parts to this. On my drawing, one, two. On the model, three, four. Let's see if it comes out the same. What?
One problem I come across with this strategy is sometimes you get, for example, the sacrum area of the left-hand side is very, very narrow. And that can be a tricky width to get sometimes as much
yeah,
narrower than you did.
For sure.
If it's so narrow, sometimes you have trouble finding something to compare it to.
Yeah. Well, so then the landmark, anything that you can find twice becomes a useful reference for you. Like down in here, this is part of the iliotibial band. This would be a better landmark than this would because you can find this and it's clear. Over here, there's going to be something you can find, but I acknowledge sometimes on the back there's a few landmarks, not as many as on the front of the figure.
Well, it's just a narrow width, it's hard to find a good comparison.
Well, sure. If I decreased this distance here, it would be as if I turned this whole figure around. It's how much you're seeing of this, depending on where you are in the room. If I keep going like this, at some point, you'll lose this distance. And you'll see the side plane. And somebody over here will be seeing front plane and not side plane and not back plane. That's why it's important when you're starting off your drawing, take a moment to look around the room and pick a spot where you've got enough to work with. I would say not to be in the shadow every time and not to be on the posterior or get a posterior view of the figure every time. Take different positions in the room. People sort of settle in and your territory, claiming certain territory each time when you come in. I wouldn't advise you to do that. I'd advise you to move around, pick a different spot. Although you shouldn't be over here all the time. Find another spot. And fall. Anyhow, one last thing on this and then we'll take our break. Here's one thing that I think will help and gives you a basic overview of size relationships, breaking it only into two pieces. And I do this all the time. Make a mark, once you've got your drawing going, make a mark at its lowest point. Make a mark at its highest point. And get them in line with each other. Bring it off to the side. This gives you the total height of the figure. And this is once you've got the figure drawn out here, you've got something to check. This is the total height of your figure. This is why I'm doing this. Question, how great should the legs be for this torso and head? How much space do we want to reserve for these flexed legs that's proportionate to this torso and the head? Well, divide it up into the least number of pieces, 2. Because that will give you how long this stuff is in relation to this, and where the interface of those two pieces are. Is. What? Plural? Is. Where the interface is. I don't know where it is. I have a yardstick here, but all numbers have fallen off. This. This is half the height. This is different than this other comparison I was making. You divide the whole thing into 2, and then you look on the model to see if indeed, from the top of the head to the iliac crest, you hold this steady on the top of the head, and move this around to the iliac crest, and then you double that to see if that's good or for good. It's like going up on the model stand and going like this. Right, half is going to be, you know, where, given a certain position. You can do that with a stick. That gives you a control over all of these proportions, not as lesser ones, as greater ones, in relation to the rest of your jaw. If you can work through this and use this, you will never, ever wind up in a state of not knowing what the relationship here should be lengthwise in relation to the torso that you have going. It can be solved. Think about that. I wouldn't be here drawing and entering into such an immensely complex and difficult situation as drawing from life if I didn't have some strategies where I could sort it out and fix it if it's broken.